All right. Thank you so much for spending your evening with us. My name is Kalen Butt, and on behalf of the Rescale family, I welcome you to the first ever Rescale Night San Francisco. In addition to all the lovely people in the audience tonight, we are streaming live around the world. So feel free to use our hashtag Rescale Night to tweet us. We have an incredibly interesting series of speakers. I've seen the slides. I've talked to these folks. This is really, really exciting stuff. So we're going to get started, first of all, with the founder and CEO of Rescale, Joris Poort.
All right. Well, thank you all for coming. Really excited to be here and introduce you to the third big wave of cloud computing. And I'm glad that everybody from our community came here today to help make cloud computing great again. All right, so in all seriousness, in the cloud, we've seen a massive transformation happen, okay? The IT industry is a $4 trillion industry, all shifting to cloud. And here in Silicon Valley, we think that everything's already in the cloud. But actually, in enterprises, only about 6% of the IT workloads are running in the cloud today. So we're really just at the very beginning of cloud computing. And if we take a look at over the last 5 years, companies and their performance over time, the ones who've truly embraced cloud have dramatically outperformed the companies who've struggled to adopt cloud computing as core of their products and their business models. So I'm going to talk about a little bit of the three major phases that we've gone through in cloud and what that really means for companies. So the first phase, which I'm sure you're very familiar with, cloud 1.0, has been software as a service. Software as a service fundamentally transformed for enterprise software the delivery model and the business model of how it's used in the enterprise. On the delivery side, went from very complex infrastructure integrations to a truly seamless browser-based delivery. On the business model side, we've gone from expensive annual licenses that are very inflexible and multi-year agreements to flexible pay-as-you-go subscription models and consumable licensing. And a few new companies have come along over the past 10 years or so, companies like Salesforce for CRM, NetSuite for ERP, and Workday for HR. They've taken advantage of this and truly disrupted the legacy players like Oracle, HP, and others. Even legacy players, though, have had the opportunity to embrace SaaS and completely outperform the market. And Adobe is a great example of this. I mean, the results just speak for themselves. As soon as they switched over from their legacy on-premise model to a SaaS subscription, they've completely outperformed their competitors. So this is cloud 1.0, software as a service. The next phase has been 2.0, big data. And even though for decades we've had access to pretty cheap storage, cloud really enabled the connectivity and the scaling of the data layer in enterprise software applications. And this has grown an entire new crop of companies for another $100 billion of value that's been created, just like SaaS. Companies like Cloudera, who really embraced the Hadoop ecosystem and delivered that for companies. Palantir, who helped bring big data technologies to governments, financial services institutions. And even Splunk, who took something as simple as logging and drove new insights from those logs and turned that into a multi-billion dollar company. So this has been a massive opportunity that's still being ongoing and growing. And now finally, we're at the cusp of cloud 3.0, and this is the rise of the big compute era. So we're just at the very beginning of this. But big compute is all about bringing specialized hardware and workloads that need these supercomputing and HPC-type capabilities to the cloud. Now, you might be thinking, hey, I already got a supercomputer in my pocket. But that's a supercomputer from over 25 years ago. Today, if you want a supercomputer, it still costs tens of millions of dollars to build that and integrate it into your data center. You might also be thinking, hey, I can go to Amazon and just spin up a bunch of servers. I can already do that. But those are commodity servers that haven't been tuned and optimized for these specialty workloads and can't run the latest and greatest technologies and simulation software or deep learning algorithms. So this is the next phase, and this is a massive opportunity for startups and for legacy companies. And this is going to drive another $100 billion wave as we move along that big shift to cloud and IT. So to dive a little deeper into this, critical component of this is the specialization of architectures. Moore's Law has been providing us these massive benefits in computing advances and better capabilities in the CPU every couple of years. But that's flattening out. So now it's coming down to, within the server, lots of specialization and fragmentation of these technologies that you need to be able to run the latest and greatest workloads. Take an example, like deep learning. If we take a look at, on the processor side, you go from general purpose of a server you can spin up on Amazon all the way to highly customized servers like what Google has done with their TensorFlow processing unit, where they've customized the chip architecture just for deep learning. So this workload, you can only run on the latest GPUs or custom architectures. In fact, it's not even possible to run a serious deep learning problem on a standard CPU. And that's just one category. There's many categories of applications that have the exact same behavior. So if you're a large enterprise and you want to do this within your enterprise for hundreds of applications, you have a fundamental challenge because you have to enable the big compute stack within your application environment. So you have hundreds of applications, you have hundreds of specialized architectures, and you have to build the integration layer to take an application and customize and tune that on a specific architecture. And that architecture might be in Amazon, it might be in Microsoft, it might be on your on-premise infrastructure. So you need to build that layer to be able to enable that. Not only that, then you have these applications that are tuned and optimized. You need to deliver that to your end users and manage it as an IT administrator. So this stack is critical to enabling a company to actually be able to use the big compute capabilities. And at Rescale, we've been spending years building this technology to be able to deliver it to customers. So on the bottom layer, we've built the largest global multi-cloud big compute infrastructure network in the world. This is available at your fingertips today if you use Rescale. We have over 40 different chip and server architectures that you can take advantage of, and these can be spun up in a pay-as-you-go, easy, seamless model. On top of this infrastructure network, we've built an ecosystem of software vendors and applications that are delivered in a turnkey fashion. And you'll hear a little later today from Ansys, the leading simulation provider, to be able to run their applications turnkey seamlessly on any of these architectures. But also open source packages like TensorFlow, Caffe, and Torch, and deep learning. These are all available in a turnkey environment. We've taken these solutions and delivered them to customers across industries. And if you look at the leading companies in any of these industries, from aerospace to automotive to life sciences and semiconductors, the leading companies in these spaces are all leveraging the big compute stack to deliver products faster and do things that were never possible before. SpaceX is able to build a rocket 3 times faster than their direct competitors because they're leveraging the big compute stack. Tesla is able to deliver a safer vehicle, and they're doing less physical testing on their cars than any of the OEMs, and they're able to do this through crash simulation on the big compute stack. And even in industries like life sciences, they've been constrained to be able to run their simulations in the drug discovery process because they're just too expensive and use too much compute to make it realistic to implement. But over the next few years, you'll see in life sciences, we'll be able to computationally develop drugs. And this is going to take a $2 billion drug discovery process down by magnitudes in costs and truly revolutionize pharmaceutical companies and their drug discovery process. Now, at Rescale, we can't do this alone. So we've done this with an entire partner ecosystem, and you'll hear from some of those today. Our customers have helped us make our products better. You'll hear from Boom, who's built a supersonic jet. You'll hear from our software partners like Ansys, leading simulation technology, tuned and optimized and integrated on top of the big compute stack. And fundamental cloud infrastructure providers like Microsoft, who have the lowest latency cloud solutions in the industry today. And thought leaders like McKinsey and Company, who are delivering the strategic thinking that's needed for executives to be able to truly go through these strategic transformations. And now I'm really excited to announce, today, with some partners, we're launching bigcompute.org. So this is a non-Rescale specific open community that anybody can join. So you can get on your phones today, sign up. If you want to stay informed and you want to be part of this community, everyone's welcome. Customers, software vendors, if you're just interested in the space, IT vendors, partners, cloud vendors, we're all there together, and we're going to help make this revolution happen in big compute. Now, finally, I'd like to leave you with one of our customer stories. So over the last year in this season, we partnered with a Formula One team who leveraged the big compute stack for some of their latest bleeding edge technologies to get ahead in the Formula One race.
Formula One is described as the pinnacle of motorsport. We race on most continents around the world. We have the best drivers, and it's incredibly competitive.
Formula One, by default, is constant innovation. But for Manor Racing, we have to be even more innovative. We have to find competitive advantage in everything we do.
The aim is always to go faster. It's very, very important to have a great computer and a great link to the car for the engineer.
We have computers on the car, logging the data for us, and then we have lots of data analysis happening back in the pits and back in the factory here. Rescale are a cloud computing provider, and they provide us with a computing resource that we can send our simulations to, and we can get a massive gain in simulation capability. So it's absolutely fantastic.
Before we had Rescale, an engineer would manually load a setup into the computer. Now we can put tens of thousands in, and it comes back 20 minutes later.
At this point, we're now doing about 4 million simulations per weekend. Whereas traditionally, you would have to buy a big data center to be able to cope with that situation. Our developers got to grips with it within a couple of days working with them. They're very good at support. They'll dedicate the resources to help you and make sure that you get up and running. But once you're up and running, you don't really need hand-holding anymore.
Rescale have lots of data centers spread all around the world, which are basically centers full of computers. And the advantage of being in different data centers around the world is we can make them run more locally. So we're not susceptible to the internet link being slow in different parts of the world. And it's very fast. Our data is massively sensitive. And with Rescale, we have that assurance that our data is safe and very secure.
It's safe, it's scalable, it's flexible. It allows us to do things we couldn't do before because of the scale of it. And it's very easy to write software and deploy software on the platform.
We're a very much cloud-enabled company. I can use all my resources for making the car faster and not for maintaining an infrastructure. It's very cost effective because I pay as I consume. So in the old way, I had to buy hardware. Now I just buy a service that makes everything possible.
Rescale have been a great partner. They are smart people. They are on the cutting edge of ideas and technology, and we are always learning from them.
All right, everybody, let's give yours a big hand. My name is Tony Spagnolo, and I run sales at Rescale. And when we were planning the Rescale night, we asked the question, who do we have as a keynote? And we all simultaneously said, Boom. Now, why did we say boom? Let me put it to you this way. How many of you have been to the National Space and Air Museum outside Dulles Airport? Anybody been there? So when you come in on the first floor, what are you looking at? You're looking at three legendary spacecraft and aircraft. In the front of you is the shuttle. To the left is the Concorde. To the right, the SR-71. And behind that SR-71, there's a nice big open space. My belief is in 30 years, that'll be a boom aircraft in that space. So with that introduction, let me introduce Josh Krall from Boom Technologies. Thank you.
How's it going? I'm happy to be here. I'm delighted to be here, actually. I hope that it's a little less than 30 years, but we'll do our best. I'm Josh Krall. I'm here. I'm the CTO of Boom Supersonic, and I want to talk to you a little bit about Boom's story and sort of how Rescale's kind of been a game changer for us as a startup aerospace company. So we spend a lot of time at Boom sort of thinking about what happens in this top corner of the slide. You know, how do we make air travel faster, and how do we expand human capability and, you know, just really enable faster transportation. And to better, you know, understand the value of speed, we sort of have to look back in history a bit and think about what it was like in the propeller airplane era. You know, New York to London was 18 hours. So not many people took an overseas trip, right? I mean, if it takes a long time to get somewhere, you don't go. You know, it's not just about how long it takes to get there. It's also about what kinds of experiences speed kind of enables. So, you know, there was no baseball west of the Mississippi. There was no such thing as a world tour for music. If you had a long-distance relationship and it with someone in another city, good luck with that. And then the jet age kind of changed all that, right? I mean, the jets came about, and it really opened up the world and made cities more accessible, made continents more accessible. The Beatles took the first world tour in 1964. And then supersonics were supposed to be next. You know, they were supposed to be to the jet airplane what the jet airplane was to the propeller airplane. And of course, we had Concorde, and as you mentioned, it's a museum piece now. And, you know, part of the problem with Concorde was it was an economic failure. I mean, the ticket prices at $20,000 round trip, you know, it was a bucket list item for many people. And so it became a museum piece. It had 26 years in service, but it wasn't a viable sort of business. It was a gas guzzler. At 100 seats, you couldn't fill the airplane on most routes. It was really only profitable on one route. And you know, this is sort of a death spiral for the possibility of making supersonics a viable, game-changer airplane. But today, you know, 50 years later, we have modern engines, modern aerodynamics, different materials, and that enables us to design an airplane that's dramatically more efficient. And that's kind of a game changer for airlines, because if you look at an airline, the front 10% of the seats make up most of the profit from that airplane. Substantial part of the revenue and most of the profit. So what we're doing at Boom right now is sort of, the idea is kind of take that front 10% of the airplane and make it go really fast. And if you can do that, then this becomes something that is viable for a whole bunch of routes. This is the airplane we're proposing. It's a 45 to 50 seat premium experience airplane, mostly sort of like a first class seat. One seat on each side of the aisle, so you have an aisle and a window seat. 2.6 times faster than anything you can get from Boeing or Airbus today. And then it's just, you know, most importantly, it's profitable. And if you look at a global route map, we can fly 500 routes profitably compared to the one route that the Concorde could. So, you know, we had a sort of well-respected industry forecaster, the Boyd Group, take a look at this, and they predicted 1,300 airplanes over 10 years, which is bigger than the 787. So this isn't a niche airplane anymore. This is something that could really revolutionize travel. So there she is. This is what we imagine the future of air travel to be. But it's not really the right thing for a startup to work on. I mean, we're a small company right now. To jump all the way to this as our first design would be very challenging. So instead, we're working on what we call the XB1 supersonic demonstrator. This is a subscale prototype. It's about one-third the size, so 65 feet long. Looks kind of like an elongated fighter jet, but it has the same wing design, same propulsion inlet design, and the same high-temperature composite airframe. So that's the XB1. We made a short video to sort of talk about the last 2 years of engineering that's been going into this airplane.
To accomplish our goal of affordable supersonic travel, we challenged our engineering team to create a design at least 30% more efficient than Concorde.
Concorde was designed 50 years ago, and its creators didn't have the technology for efficient supersonic flight. But today, we have better aerodynamics, materials, and engines. We've been working for the last 2.5 years on a revolutionary new supersonic design.
Concorde's designers worked in wind tunnels, where each iteration takes months, and only a few designs could be tested. We work in virtual wind tunnels and have already run over 1,000 simulated wind tunnel tests, allowing us to produce a refined design, a breakthrough in supersonic efficiency. First is a concept called area ruling, a dynamically shaped fuselage that minimizes cross-sectional area with a gentle tapering in the aft cabin. This minimizes disturbances to the surrounding air, reducing drag.
The number two feature is called a chine. The chine is like a little wing that extends all the way up to the nose. And what the chine does on our airplane, on a commercial aircraft for the first time, is help create natural balance throughout a wide range of speeds.
Lastly, we refine the traditional delta wing design with high efficiency airfoils and a swept trailing edge that reduces drag and helps quiet the sonic boom.
Today, we have the benefit of advanced materials. Carbon fiber composites allow us to realize the aerodynamic design with a strong, lightweight structure. To create a carbon fiber part, we first start with a high-precision mold, either CNC machined or 3D printed. We then apply layer after layer of carbon fabric and resin to the mold. Finally, each part is cured in an oven or autoclave under vacuum at temperatures of up to 450 degrees Fahrenheit. Cruising at 1,451 miles per hour, the nose and leading edges of the aircraft can reach temperatures of up to 307 degrees Fahrenheit. These carbon parts outperform aluminum at the high temperatures of supersonic flight.
Our aircraft needs a propulsion system that's powerful enough for Mach 2.2 flight, yet is also quiet and efficient. The propulsion system is composed of a variable geometry intake system and an efficient turbofan jet engine. The intake is like an adapter for supersonic flight. An intricate three-dimensional control surface creates shock waves that slow the air down to the ideal speed for the engine. Our engine is based on the same technology that powers modern subsonic aircraft, but with a customized fan and a variable geometry exhaust. Lastly, we use three engines for added reliability and safety. Two engines are under the wing, and a third is in the tail, with a unique bifurcated inlet that is both efficient and beautiful.
For the last 2.5 years, we've been working quietly on the design. Finally, the engineering is complete and we have started the build process. In just over a year, our first airplane will be ready for flight.
Okay. So that gives you a little hint of what's been going on behind the scenes in our offices in Denver. So what does this have to do with Rescale and HPC and big compute? I think, you know, as you saw, we're relying on some really important and major aerodynamic advances to make the XB1 and our production airliner more efficient than Concorde. And I just want to show you a picture of our server infrastructure. it's the one on the over here. We recently built out a lobby space in our offices, and we demolished the server room that had that rack, and it ended up in the men's bathroom. That's kind of the most startup-y thing about us, I think. But in all seriousness, you know, I show this photo because I want to drive home the difference between aerospace design today and what it was like, you know, maybe 10 years ago. So here's some pictures of some of our computational fluid dynamics work, or CFD. You know, so these are Navier-Stokes unstructured simulations of one of the corners of our flight envelope, where XB1 is experiencing what we call vortex lift, and simulating these sort of tight vortices over the wings is pretty computationally expensive, and it requires simulation meshes with 200 million cells or more in some of the simulations, and they can run from minutes to hours depending on the complexity, and we often want to run sort of whole parameterized design sweeps where we manipulate the design space and explore different, you know, geometry changes. And in addition to these external aero challenges, we also have inlet design, which, so this is a slice through the center of our inlet. A supersonic inlet is sort of designed to slow down the air so that it's at the right temperature and pressure and speed for the jet engine. And so we're looking at Mach numbers in the top one here, and then at the bottom, we're looking at pressure recovery in the inlet and engine phases. But yet, we only have a very small aero team right now. I mean, these two aerodynamicists, this is Marshall Gussman in the top and Kenrick Waith in the bottom right, they do the majority of our simulation. And it just drives home that if you have really talented engineers with experience in the domain and you give them the right software and the right compute resources, you can actually accomplish quite a lot compared to sort of the traditional way of working. So when people ask me about Rescale, and I often tell them sort of, I like to think of it as you know, we let our engineers ask what kind of supercomputer do they want today. And in fact, they can sort of ask that on every job they submit to Rescale. So depending on the complexity of the job or how fast they want the result, how much money they want to pay, they can dial in exactly how much compute resources they have and get a result quite efficiently. This is an example of some aero database plots that we've created, where every one of these dots is a simulation that may have taken, you know, an hour or so on 100 cores or something like that. And so we'll run a sweep like this and sort of on demand be able to grab all the compute capacity to get this aero database built. And we don't have to think anything about IT or how to manage all that data. You know, traditionally you would have to have a team of people sort of, you know, collecting all the data, collating it, validating it, checking it, putting it in the right places, et cetera. Or you'd have to have a software team write all that scripting to automate this process. And we were able to skip all that because of Rescale. So CFD pictures are kind of cool, but wind tunnels are cooler. So I thought I'd show a quick little video of what we're really simulating here. Okay, so this is what we've been up to at Boom, and obviously it's a tremendous amount of work from our engineering team, and obviously tons of simulations on Rescale to get us to this point where we can validate in a wind tunnel and confirm that our simulations are actually doing what they're supposed to. So these are our two airplanes. We're hard at work on the first one, and it's fully funded, and we're just beginning to begin manufacturing on it. And I want to just sort of take a step back and think a little bit about what, you know, why we're doing this and what it how it matters to the world. So New York to London can be 3.5 hours or so, and that's like taking an early morning flight out of New York. You're in London, downtown London, by mid-afternoon or early afternoon. You can have some business meetings. You can go to dinner and then catch the last flight of the day back and be home in time to tuck your kids into bed. San Francisco to Tokyo is 5 hours, 24 minutes. Pretty meaningful difference there. And then San Francisco to Singapore, 7 hours, 31 minutes. It's half the time, but it's also days off of your trip. I mean, you can leave here and be on a completely different sleep schedule than you would today, where you basically have to try to get, you know, the best lay flat bed experience you can on an airplane and get a bunch of crappy sleep and then hope that you're fresh enough to have your important business meeting the next day. I just want to leave you with a sort of video we made that kind of drives home why this is important to us.
The pursuit of speed is often relegated to the adrenaline seekers, the risk takers, the record breakers. But our pursuit of speed is about something greater. It's speed in service of the experiences that make life precious. Imagine, if you will, flying across the Atlantic, doing business, and being home in time to tuck your children into bed, or where New Zealand becomes as accessible as New York. What would that do for families, for culture, for business? The technology for supersonic flight has existed for over 50 years.
This is the new supersonic airplane.
But it was too expensive for routine travel. At Boom, we are refining it, perfecting it, so that high-speed travel can be available to anyone. In the digital age, there really is no more distance. There is only time, time from one another. Our mission is to remove that barrier, meaning more meetings in a day and more nights with loved ones, where children grow up with their parents at home, and where relationships are no longer considered long distance. We see New York to London in 3 hours instead of 7, San Francisco to Tokyo in 5 hours instead of 11. We see world leaders spending more time in the same room, the acceptance of cultures, and the spreading of ideas. At Boom, we see the time saved as really the least important part. This isn't about time saved. It's about life gained. Together, we can make cities into neighborhoods and make the world a smaller place. Boom. The future is supersonic.
Okay, so I hope that sort of drives home why it matters to us and why some of this amazing technology that the folks here at Rescale have been working on really matters. And this is just a picture of some of our team out in Denver. We have some of the best aerospace minds in the world working on this problem. And if this is something that inspires you, please come talk to me. We're going to be hiring like crazy lately, so I want to hear from you. And that's it. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to you guys. We're huge fans of Rescale, and we wouldn't be where we are today without them. So thanks a lot.
Thanks, Josh. It's exciting aircraft. As much as I want to see it in a museum, what I really want to do is fly it. So I'm looking forward to the day. So our next speaker is from ANSYS, and when I was talking to Ray, when I first interfaced with ANSYS, which was a long time ago, I'm older than you think, or younger than you think, I should say, but the company was called Swanson Analysis. It was run by a person named John Swanson, and it actually wasn't the leader in CAE in terms of revenue. Since that time, it's grown fantastically. For those of you that had the honor to own their stock, you've been rewarded tremendously. It's now the largest simulation company, pure play simulation company in the world. Over the past 30 years, they've executed fantastically. And today, they have one of the most comprehensive and leading edge elastic licensing systems in the industry. We're happy to work with them. We love working with their team. And with that, let me introduce you to Ray Milhelm, VP of Solutions and Cloud.
Good evening, everybody. I want to thank Joris and the Rescale team for inviting us today. I also want to thank Microsoft Ventures for hosting us here. Thank you for attending. I just have really a few slides to tell you about our relationship and our open cloud strategy and relationship with Rescale. So I joined ANSYS about, this is my fourth year. Actually, I used to be part of this area, beautiful Bay Area, and I was recruited to establish the cloud team at ANSYS. And ANSYS, as Tony was mentioning, is one of the best kept secrets in the world, truly one of the leaders in simulation engineering. Some of you who worked in this world as a CAE, computer-aided engineering. I am not a simulation engineer, but I am very passionate about simulation engineering and clearly very passionate about cloud. And the first thing I learned is that almost everything we use has some simulation in it, whether it's from ANSYS or from other companies, but the phone you use or the car you use or the plane you fly or the car you ride has clearly a lot of smart engineers working on designing, simulating the products and building it. And the first thing we always say with ANSYS is really this is our what we do. We enable our customers to build their virtual prototypes, to test everything, whether it's the great products like Boom or cars or phones or all kinds of products. ANSYS, as a publicly traded company, has almost 46,000 customers globally. And you know, like half of my team are PhDs. I'm the only one who's not a PhD. I'm double E in computer science. And I learned a lot from all these smart guys and girls in our team. So the software really is an enabler. It gives our customers the ability to do the virtual prototyping and then ultimately run it. So, you know, some cases, customers just want to run it on site, on-prem. And a lot of cases, customers want to run it on the cloud. And we'll talk about that in a minute. So, when I say the best kept secret, it's truly the all the complexities of physics and solvers. And as Tony was mentioning, our founder was is a PhD from CMU and hired a lot of people from all over the country and the world to build this great company. So one of our customers, our largest customer, is General Electric, and I'm sure a lot of you has even worked with them or used their products and interacted with them some shape or form. At the minimum, when you fly planes, some of the engines are either Rolls-Royce, Pratt & Whitney, or GE, at a minimum. So GE, as this is a public statement from their CIO, I think it was 2 years ago at reInvent, I don't recall, yep, 2015, where he stated in front of the whole world that GE will start shutting down their data centers gradually and migrate almost approximately 9,000 workloads to the cloud gradually. And that statement is an amazing, powerful, passionate statement that shows innovation and creativity, that GE understands that their business is building engines, their business is building nuclear, their business is building all kinds of amazing products. Their business is not running IT centers. Their business is not running cloud, et cetera. And that philosophy or that mentality really applies to a lot of customers that we deal with, a lot of customers that Rescale deals with, and probably some of you in the audience here, is that I want to get software. I want to run it on the cloud. I really don't want to bother with IT and data centers and all that stuff. Clearly, on-site IT systems will not disappear. Data centers will always be there. There will always be some interfaces between on-prem, on-site, and the cloud with a lot of the hybrid technologies that are coming up. But if I was at a startup and I was kind of like want to do my business today, I'm not going to build IT centers. I'm not going to build clusters. I really just want to build it on the cloud. And a lot of companies, I'm sure a lot of you here, are part of that ecosystem that born on the cloud, you know, instead of investing time and money in IT. You see also the state of manufacturing. I like this quote. I got the numbers. 50% of manufacturers attribute cloud solutions to make it easier to introduce new products. That's exactly the idea, is that it's easier because it's a time to market. Everybody's under pressure. I managed engineering teams in different companies. There's always that pressure to create the product, low cost, time to market, on time, lower the budget, et cetera, et cetera. So everybody's under pressure from whether you're a startup or you're a big company, you wanna be efficient in your resources, you wanna run your software right, you wanna be dealing with the right companies, et cetera. And another quote I liked is the savings. Also goes back to the same points we were talking, just like what Joris mentioned earlier, just like Boom was saying, is that at the end of the day, it's all about cost efficiencies. You want to cut the CapEx, you want to cut the capital expenditure, you want to cut the OPEX, the operating expenditure. You want to be smart about your workflows and which platform do you want to run, how efficient, time to market, etc. So at ANSYS, we created something called ANSYS Open Cloud Strategy. It's really not a rocket science, it's just me and a bunch of my guys. We have a lot of smart people, smarter than me, working for me and our cloud team at ANSYS. And we kept saying, you know, we wanted to build our own solution, which I'll talk about it briefly. But then we said, you know, there are a lot of great players in the ecosystem of cloud. One of them is clearly Rescale. So what we said, three fundamental things. We said, ANSYS as a simulation engineering company, that we're gonna stay true to that. We're leaders in physics, multiphysics, system level, et cetera. And over the years, we've been acquiring a lot of different companies. And as Tony said, we're a publicly traded company, and we have all these great customers globally, from startups to very large companies. So we said, number one, we're a simulation engineering company. It's not gonna change. Number two, we are what we call hardware agnostic, meaning if the hardware is residing on-prem, or the hardware is a machine, virtual machine, a public cloud, or it's using cloud hosting partners like Rescale, we're hardware agnostic. We test and certify our physics, our solvers on all these different platforms. The third one, we said we're deployment agnostic. Customers say, you know what, I'm not gonna move to the cloud next year, but I might move to the cloud in 2 years or 3 years. Other customers will say, I wanna move to the cloud, but I might wanna work with you, ANSYS, and a public cloud company, or I wanna work with a cloud hosting partner like a Rescale. So we had to, truly, when we say open cloud strategy, we truly mean it. We had to stick by our strategy. We have a lot of customers now using the strategy, adopting our software on these different platforms. And in the middle, what we did is that we created a single tenant solution. We call it ANSYS Enterprise Cloud, that's running on AWS today, that complements other solutions, and it's targeting large customers, and it's a global solution. On our roadmap, we want to continue working also with Microsoft Azure. We want to continue working with Google Cloud. So, collaboration with Rescale. Customer benefits, we always think about, at the end of the day, we're all salespeople, whether you're an engineer or a manager or director, VP. At the end of the day, you want to create the best product and you want to sell it to the market. So customer benefits, there are several points that we listed here. So first of all, creating or running a turnkey solution that we partner with Rescale to run the solution for a lot of customers, and some of you are here in the audience, with their global HPC data centers, as Joris was talking about. The second one is the ease of use. Rescale has also a very advanced, very fancy, easy to use user interface that anybody, engineer or analyst, he or she can use it easily. And that's very simple, because you don't want to complicate the engineer or analyst world by giving them difficulty to access the cloud resources. You want to make it easy through a browser and a security, through a portal and so on. And the third thing is that customer benefits. Rescale also has also multiple options. They have the options to work on public cloud, they have an option to work with private clouds, and then clearly on site or on-prem. A lot of times They deal with different companies for sure. We are one of the leading ISVs in the simulation engineering company, but they have a whole ecosystem of simulation engineering companies that they work with. And the last thing is security. They have a very advanced security standards. Some of it is related to ITAR, DoD security, and that's very critical and very important. And that's something that also Rescale offers to the customers who are running our software as part of a solution. This is just to show you the collaboration, the different physics that we have, whether it's CFX, Fluent, which are part of the CFD, Computational Fluid Dynamics, or we have a lot of products that we have on the EMAG, Electromagnetic HFSS and Maxwell. And then just to give you an idea about the different physics and the access to the software. This is the giving you an idea about the whole turnkey solution. So on the left, as Joris was explaining earlier, you have the SAS interface, the Rescale SAS interface, and all the access to engineers, data center, data scientists, analysts, etc. Then you have the software library using licenses like a BYOL, bring your own license, or using our Elastic licensing, which is the pay-per-use per hour. And that was the first time in the industry that an ISV in the simulation offers a very advanced, scalable solution like that. And then clearly leveraging the Rescale platform as a service, which is also a very advanced, very easy to use solution. And last but not least, the global HPC. Because a lot of you in the audience, if you're an engineer or in the simulation area, you'll need HPC clusters. As the gentleman from Boom was mentioning, instead of building these clusters and data centers, you can leverage a Rescale HPC platform, make it easier for you to build and deliver your products. And then maybe here, just this is an example of the access from the SAS access to specify which input files for your specific workflow, selecting the ANSYS software, selecting which compute, which type of compute you want, depending on the storage, on the back end, etc. And then clearly running the job, and that's also critical because sometimes different back ends have different interfaces and different MPI requirements. So I just have a couple of examples, use cases. This company is a large company in Korea, and the Rescale team did a great job working with our local team in Korea and delivering the solution. Just like any company, there are a lot of pain points. So for example, there were simulation challenges with the results being slow. The engineers were challenged that they want to focus on building the products, the different products that the company has in the power distribution. Another thing is that their current infrastructure, they didn't have enough HPC infrastructure, they didn't have enough expertise in HPC. Believe me, if you ask the teams, people who work in HPC, there's a lack of HPC expertise out there. It's not a large pool, it's a smaller pool. And the do-it-yourself infrastructure as a service was also a costly solution for this customer, for LSIS. It required a lot of system integration partners. There's no long-term support. So finally, with the lack of also challenges they had with licenses, the Rescale team had a very good solution saying that they can work with us, with ANSYS, with our software, leveraging Elastic licensing so the customer can use a very large pool of all these licenses, covers HFSS or Maxwell or CFD, a lot of our software, mechanical, and so on and so forth. And that allows the customer to have that flexibility and pay per hour, just like you have elasticity for, let's say, HPC clusters on the cloud, you'll have elasticity on the software licensing. And then final example is, I had the pleasure of meeting Seth from RCR, Seth, and I learned a lot about this great company. Thanks to Tony and Seth, I learned a lot about racing in 5 minutes tonight. Great company and a lot of talented engineers. I think you have 550 people or something and about 150 engineers or so. It's all the talent. I always believe that when you have talented people and great leadership and a clear focus, the sky's the limit. You can do anything in this world. So they had the similar challenges, simulation challenges, developing in-house, unmet simulation needs. They also had the same challenges as the other customer, and a lot of customers probably have this, is the lack of HPC infrastructure and then also the expertise, whether it's the IT or HPC expertise. The do-it-yourself was also costly and it did not work for them. And finally, partnering with us, Ansys, and with Rescale provided RCR and really an advanced solution, very high performance, easy to use, leveraging the Rescale cloud, solution cloud. So in summary, really, the two examples, just to summarize what we're trying to say, is that ultimately, innovation and creativity will always be there. As Joris was saying earlier, cloud computing is here to stay. It will never be 100% everything on the cloud. For sure, there will be always data centers and interface between on-premise and on the cloud. But as innovation continues, as the software gets more complex, as the needs get more complex, like the boom example, supersonic, you have to have certain designs in place as you want to do faster cars so you can compete with other high-end, high-performance cars. Everything has to be optimized, whether it's the software, the simulation engineering, or the back-end cloud. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you very much again. Have a great night.
Thanks, Ray. So our next speaker is from Microsoft, and before I get into a little bit of introduction, I want to thank Microsoft for letting us host this event at their facility. Fantastic facility. I met Matt for the first time, and we were commiserating a little bit about the traffic in Seattle. If you've ever tried to make it from Redmond to the airport during rush hour, it's a disaster. I call that the Microsoft traffic jam. It's not going to get any better, folks. They got a great cloud strategy. These guys are transforming the business. It's a great offering, and the traffic's going to get worse. So with that, I'd like to introduce Matt Thompson, Senior Product Manager from Microsoft Azure. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's great to have a partner like Rescale, because working in Azure engineering focused on high-performance computing means that we can actually focus on infrastructure and building infrastructure at scale. Within the Azure engineering team for HPC, we've got products and services like HPC Pack, which is a hybrid on-premise to Azure scheduler. We've got Azure Batch, which is both an IaaS and a PaaS offering for almost a scheduler as a service. And then we've been releasing some new VMs. So we've just released what we're calling H-Series, which is the fastest VM in the public cloud. It's the Haswell processor with InfiniBand on the back end, and also N-Series, so our NVIDIA GPU offering, both the K80 for compute and the M60 for visualization. I wanted to talk a little bit about our experience in dealing with some of the complexities of infrastructure at scale to give you a view on what we see and what we learn. The ecosystem within big compute is very important. We think it's about $430 billion. And we believe that by 2020, for a public cloud provider, the target addressable market will be something like $33 billion. So there's a good chunk of change out there that we're desperately scrambling for against the likes of AWS and Google. I wanted to touch on what we see from the end user. There's a lot of pressure on their levels of productivity, on high levels of production, keeping up with competition, yet either maintaining their budget spend or in some cases reducing it. So how can they do that and leverage innovation and keep up with the rate of change that's required? I think they also want the concept of only paying for what they use and only paying for what they need. I think it's the first time that we can genuinely say that customers are thinking about cloud first. And that might not be everything's going to cloud. It might be a portion of the job. It might be a process in the workflow. but they're definitely asking that question first. What can we put in the cloud first, and what can we hold back on-premise? An example of that would be Hendrick Motorsports. So you've heard similar examples already, so I won't dwell on this too much, but with a budget of $1,000 per race, Hendrick Motorsports were able to reduce costs on tires, on fuel, on optimizing for races by bursting into the cloud, running their simulations, and then analyzing those outputs through Azure Machine Learning to be able to prepare for a race. On race day, they're able to read the car indicators and data outputs to make comparison against the simulations they've run beforehand to decide when is a good time to pit, when is a good time to fuel, when is a good time to change their tires. As a small outfit, this gives them an opportunity to compete with some of the larger players in the racing division. From a cloud provider's perspective, I'm glad to say that our data center is not like Mark's, and there is not a toilet in there. With 32 regions across the globe, each region consists of up to 16 data centers, each data center being circa 2 football fields, of which I believe you can get 4 747s. We're near to 20 million servers globally. We've laid 1.6 million miles of fiber, and for new entrants coming into the market, if you wanted to be able to lay dark fiber, actually skills are very limited and have been tapped into until 2020. So you can imagine this is a very competitive market between what we consider to be the three big players. I wanted to give you an example of how some of this innovation is leading to being able to challenge areas and do more with some of the data outputs. So in talking about enabling innovation, having released our N-series offering with GPU, research is now being developed into identifying pre-triggers to identify what might cause a tornado of an F4 or F5 type. That previously was very laborious on CPU, so for a research team with a very low budget, being able to take advantage of that is very important. This is not a movie, it's actually a streaming calculation. So it allows the research team to visualize into the data and make some changes to see what might occur. These are the types of things that we're trying to enable. When we talk about the ISV community, and it was obviously very nice to hear from ANSYS, there's been a huge investment in their research and development, and that's been taking place for years. We would be nowhere without that, without our ISV community investing and making those right actions. And that's not, you know, that's not our focus. We're trying to enable the tools that you want to use in an open platform where you can make the changes you require. What we do recognize is that there needs to be a transition potentially in how partners, customers can consume those tools and applications. I think it's fair to say Microsoft made a similar transition with Office. What was considered, you know, maybe a dying product, very stagnant with customers being on legacy versions, we've now made a transition into Office 365, and we're seeing that in the HPC community also. So we encourage that and hope that continues. And an example of that would be Schlumberger. So their reservoir simulation that they've made available as a software as a service has enabled some of our customers to be able to maintain their work within Petrel, which is the application they use, and then run the simulations into Azure across our InfiniBand backbone. So I've already highlighted the ISV community, but I think obviously we're here because of Rescale. You've already heard about their turnkey solution and the fact that they support up to 180 of your software applications that you use on a daily basis. It's important and probably worth adding that this has all been optimized for Azure, so we're, you know, delighted to support this event today and obviously for me to speak. I am sat at the booth over there next to the wine, so if anybody's got any questions, then please follow up. Thank you.
Hey everyone, I'm Fanny. I'm the director of solution for Rescale. So here in the Silicon Valley, we like buzzword, right? We like the cloud. We like being social, obviously. We like a little bit of disruption as well. And we like to make the world a better place. In the manufacturing world, we have our own buzzword too, which is digital manufacturing. So today we decided that we have all those great speakers and that would be a good opportunity for us to try to understand how we can transform this buzzword into actual reality. So I'd like to welcome back on stage all of our speakers. So Matt, Josh, and Ray. And to moderate this panel, I'd like to invite Subbu Narayanan from McKinsey. So he's an associate at McKinsey at the Chicago office. And he's an expert in digital manufacturing and IoT. So it's a pleasure for us to have you here on stage. Thank you.
Thank you, Fanny. Well, I have the dubious distinction of standing between you and drinks and networking. So we'll try our best to stick to our time. And thank you all for being here as well. Just before we get started with this, we just wanted to get a poll of the audience. So how many of you represent manufacturing companies or makers? Okay, so maybe like 5-10%. How many of you are in the software development or providing solutions to manufacturers? Okay, a fair amount. And how many of you represent the startup community? Maybe overlap, yeah? Okay, got it. So you get the sense for the kind of audience we have. So today's conversation we're going to have over the next 20 minutes or so is going to hinge around two or three different topics. And it's mostly around taking all of the great stuff that you all are doing, great stuff that the companies here are doing, and really thinking about how do we implement it within manufacturing companies, and how do we actually bring it to life, and what gets in the way. So those are the types of topics that we're going to talk with these guys about. And especially with the, we have a unique panel here. We have two service providers, so to speak, and one manufacturer, so to speak, right? So we have a unique three sets of unique perspectives that you will get here. So to get started, one of the things that we've heard a lot through the presentations that you made was around the excitement you had around different things that are emerging that's going to disrupt manufacturing. And when I talk about manufacturing, let's think about designing and making. So that entire value chain. So my first question really is, and this is something I always ask anybody I meet in this space, what is it that is so exciting about all of these emerging technologies and solutions going into manufacturing? And why are you excited right now, right at this moment?
Great question, Subbu. One example I was thinking about is, this word digital twin is a huge area, digital manufacturing, digital twin, et cetera. But really, if you start thinking about what is digital twin, it's I believe General Electric, GE, started the idea, the concept, and a lot of great companies in the world started thinking about digital twin manufacturing. I know our colleagues at Siemens and Dassault, with also Ansys, obviously, and others are thinking about that world. Basically, what that world is, and this is some of the public information we've shared, we're partnering with GE Predix, and we're partnering with PTC ThingWorks. What we're doing that makes us exciting is that our simulation software is more of a, think about it as a prescriptive analytics. Prescriptive as in the simulation, what if scenarios, I've designed the product this way. So that's the prescriptive analytics. The predictive is when you're already built a car or a tractor. That's a real life example I was telling Subbu that I've seen it in my own eyes. a very large company who built beautiful tractors, shipped this tractor, and that tractor had a lot of sensors on it, IoT sensors. They sense the humidity, they sense the oil, the temperature, all kinds of sensors in that tractor. So that all the data, the traffic that's coming from that tractor in the field, is sending sensors and sending a lot of real-time feedback to a center, like let's say a data center or a cluster. And in the same area, there's the existing software, let's say our simulation software with ANSYS, that's the prescriptive analytics. So the engineers who build that tractor, they have the data, how is the product, the tractor in this case, supposed to behave. When it's done and finally manufactured and sent in the field, the actual driver and the people who are driving it and sending this data, you're comparing the predictive analytics, which is the IoT real-life data, to the prescriptive analytics, the simulation that happens. So the engineers and analysts start looking at that data and saying, aha, there's this problem. I should have designed the engine this way. There's another issue. I could have enhanced the wheels. I could have done something with the front of the tractor for air or something. So all this stuff, it sounds like rocket science, but it's actually real. It's happening. And it leverages big data. It leverages a lot of analytics. Clearly, simulation plays a part. The IoT as sensors and stuff plays a part. And all this stuff, you can easily deploy it on the cloud. I know that AWS has solutions. I know that Rescale has solutions, Azure, Google, et cetera. So it's an exciting field. It's brand new. We don't see it every day, but it eventually helps with preventive maintenance, loopback mechanisms, and you can take the same example to an engine, a plane, a car, and so on.
Possibilities are endless, yeah.
I think I'll take the sort of startup lens on this, which is to say that when we started Boom and we were just getting going, we had essentially myself as the software team, and we imagined over time we would build out quite a large software team, and especially to focus on infrastructure to make it so that our aerospace engineers that we are also going to have to hire a whole bunch of. Would have the compute infrastructure they'd need, and as it turned out, because of companies like Rescale, we were able to sort of just grow the team on the aerospace side and avoid and delay building out the software infrastructure, and that completely changed the kind of hiring plan and growth plan for the company, because if we could put all of our energy towards just solving the aerospace problems that we have, then it's just a different mix of talent, and to date, we still haven't really built out a full software infrastructure team because we haven't needed to. And I think that's a completely different mix of talent that you would have had to have at a different stage, 10 years ago. So it completely changed the way a hardware company looks at our stage today than it would have looked, before. So
yeah, I think I echo that sentiment. It's reducing the cost of failure. It's enabling you to try things that you wouldn't have tried before, and we see that across all industries. There's a real hot buzz around blockchain at the moment, and all of these different flavors that you could go out and try, and all of these different things that will solve different problems. But if you as a company or an individual want to try that, and you're going to go and deploy your own infrastructure, and you're going to go and hire your own skills to do that, well, that's obviously a huge investment on something that you don't even know if it's going to pay off. So obviously I advocate the cloud because I work in it, but being able to spin up a VM, deploy a piece of software, and then switch it off 10 minutes later is fantastically attractive for you to try something out and give it a go. And if it doesn't work, then it doesn't cost you that much. And that's where we're seeing a lot of change within the industries.
Yep. I just want to add one more thing to complement what the gentleman mentioned, is that it's at the end of the day, it's all economics. It's time to market, it's efficiency, it's delivering the product, keep enhancing the products. So that's part of the digital machinery or digital twin world.
So when I asked one of my clients who had been in a company for 3 or 4 years, how long had he been in the company? He said 16 quarters. So in the you know, I wanted to take this conversation from, this is a huge paradigm change, right? There is a boom here, you started in 2014-ish, and in 2 years, you're talking about production already, right? Where in aerospace industries, you're used to thinking about 7-10 year cycles. There's a huge paradigm change, but at the same time, we're only scratching the surface when it comes to adoption of these technologies at legacy manufacturers, which is obviously the big untapped potential. So in a situation where people are living quarter to quarter, all the decision makers are living quarter to quarter, what are some of the barriers that you see in adoption of these really exciting technologies which are ready to be adopted, but we don't really see them getting as much traction? What's happening over there? What have you guys seen, especially for, you know, Matt and Ray? You've been to many companies and you've seen this. What's exactly happening there?
I think it depends on the size of the company. But like I was saying earlier, if I was a startup born in the cloud, so to speak, like Boom, I would immediately leverage the cloud and work with partners like Rescale and others. So that's one segment, is the startup segment, the smaller companies, and because it's, again, economics and efficiencies and stuff. Medium-sized companies, sometimes they struggle with existing investment in IT, and it's going to be hard for them. Some struggle with IT, some start moving their workloads to the cloud. The large companies really have everything. Like I've seen people who totally reject cloud. Like I remember one meeting a couple of years ago, I was going to meet the CIO of a large company, and halfway through the meeting, he goes, "Ray, I don't want to hear about the cloud. I just built 3 data centers. I don't care about cloud computing." Okay, so I mean, I wish you told me before I flew to meet with you. You know, so waste my time and your time. So even the large companies, they have a spectrum. Some people are struggling understanding the workflows, their engineering talent, their complexities of manufacturing, their legacy that they have, working with us and other third-party companies. They're global, so they have to deal with teams in India and China and Europe and South America and all that stuff. And then they have the licensing stuff that at least we've have a solution for. So really, especially large companies, there's a spectrum. Mid-sized companies are more adapting to cloud, and startups for sure are more in tuned and adapting to cloud.
Yeah, if we look at banking and financial services as an example, huge issues with legacy applications. I don't know if you've picked up, but I'm English, and banking, having banked with both Lloyds and Royal Bank of Scotland, that have been in the press lately because you can't take money out of their bloody ATM machines and you can't get online to see how much money you've got or whether you've been paid. And it's all because they've acquired and merged with various banks over the years and accumulated this massive problem of what do we do with these legacy applications, where the person who designed it is probably no longer around anymore. Trying to deal with those issues, you then try to think about how can you embrace a hybrid model. So what can you push into the cloud to improve the performance, the reliability, the high availability, and what has to remain on-premise? And that's extremely sensitive within financial services because of regulation and compliance. And that's where, as a public cloud provider, we try to tackle that problem every day, along with companies like Rescale, how we try to help you evolve and transform in a way that's controlled and within the requirements and standards of the regulatory bodies.
Yeah, so I think when I think about challenges and related to this, at my company, we're sort of moving from the seed stage phase of the company into sort of more of a growth phase. And at the seed stage, it's relatively obvious what software and technologies you're going to use. We're clearly going to be in the cloud. That was an easy decision. But then the next level of decisions are sort of driven by what talent you have. So you hire the best aerodynamicists you can, and the software they want to use is clearly what you're going to start with. But as you move into the growth phase, then you start to have to look at, well, when you have a team, a large team of engineers, do you begin to standardize around specific technologies? Do you adopt something like ANSYS, you know, because it has a little bit more widespread adoption in the industry? And it's actually very encouraging to see ANSYS, you know, moving to the cloud and being available on Rescale, because it gives us a way to sort of slowly transition into a different tool set over time. Whereas we, you know, historically we would have had to say, okay, well, we were on Rescale before, but now we have to build up this big infrastructure and laid out much of capital investment as a growth stage company on things that we would rather not be spending money on. So I think it's a challenging time for a startup, but it's challenging for the right reasons, because we have to we're focusing on what technologies we want to use, not how to get them implemented.
Yeah, exactly. And when we think about adoption and when we speak to clients, it's typically three or four reasons keep coming up, right? One of them is the whole business case, right? There is a business problem forward, back versus technology forward, right? It's not just about, oh, here's an array of technology I can choose from, but it's what problem is the technology going to solve for me? And back to the 16 quarters example. Right? The other thing is the legacy system that Matthew touched on. The third is around the talent. So there is just a overall talent scarcity in the industry, at least my personal opinion, on whenever you want to take and adopt some of these technologies, the people who are actually operating and using these technologies, there is a huge upskilling needed. That's going to be a big issue. I think there's a fourth one, which we didn't touch upon here, but it's around the cybersecurity, right? I was speaking with someone, and they basically said there are only two types of companies: the company that has been hacked and the company that doesn't know that they've been hacked. Right? So there's a huge mindset of cloud is less secure compared to having everything locally or on premise. So any thoughts around how you've seen the adoption vary based on these beliefs, and how do you tackle such questions from manufacturers?
Excellent question. Maybe 5 years ago in the public arena, if somebody said, I want to move my workloads, including CRM and ERP, and not just engineering simulation, to any cloud, there is a million questions about security, for sure. And I was one of these people asking a lot of questions and all that stuff. I think nowadays, the technology is very advanced. The public cloud providers like Azure and AWS and Google do an excellent job with many, many layers. I mean, when I check your website on security, it's like 30 pages, ITAR and SOC and you name it. But to answer your question, Subbu, I did some work in a previous life in cybersecurity, and there's, as the security experts will tell you, there's no such thing as 100% security. You want 100% security, you don't use cell phone, you don't use laptop, lock yourself up in the house, or you know what I mean, like totally disconnect from the world. So the best thing, as far as all the security experts would tell you, is the cloud is as secure as the data center, on-site, on-prem. I think that approach is more realistic and logical, but a lot of large public cloud providers have done a phenomenal job, truly, because I know you guys have GovCloud, the Microsoft Azure, I know AWS have the same. And that's mostly, a lot of it is US defense and nuclear and many other things that are needed. But security also, like I'll tell you how we addressed it at ANSYS. That was the first year, it was really challenging because we had a lot of questions from engineering and IT and questioning the security, why would I move to a cloud, etc. We built a very simple model, we call it the triangle. We said security is a shared responsibility. We, as ANSYS, as an ISV, we have a responsibility to encrypt, authenticate our software, do the best we can in our software as an ISV. Clearly, the public cloud providers like Azure also have a responsibility, multiple layers of security that they do. And the customer, whether startup like Boom or a GE or anybody, truly their IT security have a responsibility because they already have their own security policy, who's going to access which port, what is authentication, and what level of authentication, encryption, etc. So truly, that's what the model we built, a triangle that shared responsibility, ISV, public cloud, and a customer. And that works because if the customer blames us, that's wrong. If the customer blames public cloud, it's wrong. Public cloud, you know. So it has to be done in a very cohesive fashion. And even with that, there will be problems. But, you know, you do the best you can on all levels.
Yeah, I completely agree. We go to the nth degree to secure Azure. And I would say that it's far more secure than any other on-premise data center. Our policy is actually we assume breach from minute one, and we run various algorithms to identify behaviors that look suspicious, and those are constantly training themselves to find new patterns. What I would add is that in some instances we found organizations, and particularly financial services, where they've had a breach for over 200 days and they haven't even known about it. You know, they assume securing at the firewall is the necessity and the be-all and end-all, but actually it often turns out to be a dumb employee or a malicious employee who's done something internally. So it's an assumed breach is the way that we kind of operate to ensure that we don't incur those problems. However, it is also the responsibility of the customer, as Ray has said, that you kind of follow the guidelines and the principles that we advocate because, you know, you have, being that it's an open platform, you have the opportunity to choose your architecture and your deployment, and therefore you have to make all of the considerations that you might need to do, whether that a leave on performance or security.
So the last question for the day, we have a fair amount of startup community represented here. What's your advice for them? One or two sentences of what's your advice that you would give the folks in the audience?
Keep working hard and do the best you can because there's nobody perfect. There's startups are not perfect, big companies are not perfect. But seriously, the best advice is that keep innovating, keep pushing the envelope, keep learning. It's like the gentleman from Boom, that's amazing technology. That when you stop innovating, you die. It's as simple as that. And it's definitely Silicon Valley, but it's a global phenomenon. So my humble advice to startups, I mean, you guys can teach us a lot or teach me a lot of stuff. The humble advice is keep working hard, keep innovating, keep looking outside the box, work with partners like Rescale. They're very innovative, very smart team of people that we have a lot of respect for. Watch your cash, CapEx and OpEx. Hire talented people as Josh was saying, the top talent. And every startup, at least my colleagues and friends here in the room, I know some of you, whether, you know, clearly Rescale or Frame, or my friend Mo came from Vancouver, a startup, to attend this event. The innovation, creativity, you got to keep going. You got to push the envelope and all that. So that's my humble advice.
So my advice, if I'm humble enough to give any, is pick an inspiring mission, something that you really believe in, because it's hard. And if you don't really feel it, then coming to work every day is going to be difficult. And on top of that, my co-founder Blake, who's the CEO, likes to say there's a sort of an inverse relationship between the ambition of your startup and how difficult it is. Because the more ambitious it is and the more exciting it is, the easier it is to find amazing talent to work on it with you. And that's what really matters in the early stages, is getting the right people and the right team. So, don't be afraid of shooting high, I guess, is what I'd say.
And I think my advice would be maybe to utilize your network. So, Microsoft, Google, AWS, they all have startup communities where they help with credit and marketing support and access to sellers and to venture capitalists. So if you can get into some of those networks and communities, obviously work that very hard, because it will identify new opportunities, it will create new partnerships, and it might just keep your company afloat.
Great. So find an inspiring mission, utilize your network, work hard, and think outside the box. And there you have it. That's the mantra for success. Thank you all. Thank you, guys.
So we have one. We actually have one more presentation. Are you having fun yet? Yeah. Okay. So to finish Rescale Night, we're excited to demo some of our new and coolest functionality. So I'd like to welcome on stage Adam McKinsey, CTO and co-founder of Rescale. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Fanny. I'm going to talk a bit about the product, some of the things we're working on, and demo some of the new features we got coming out in Rescale. So to build a platform for big compute, you need a great team. And we've managed to assemble that team here at Rescale. Now, a lot of them are out here in the audience today. Look for anybody wearing Rescale gear. Please raise your hand if you're out there. There they are, yes. So go talk to them with any questions you might have. You know, we have experts in HPC, simulation, deep learning, software, and cloud. And so we've really built the team to build the big compute stack. Now, this is the third time you've seen this slide today, so I won't go into it too deep. But I really want to concentrate on the bottom area down here. So building effective HPC is hard. And we've been spending the past 5 years doing just that. So for a typical engineer to go and try to expand their HPC capabilities, they need to involve their IT department, needs to take time, capital expenditures, or they need to go to the cloud and figure out how to make all of that work. This is what we've been doing for a long time. We make it easy. You don't have to have capital expenditures. It's easy. Just provision it. It's on demand. You're ready to go. Rescale takes all of this complexity and packages it in a nice, easy-to-use SaaS platform. Now we have over 300 features across 12 categories. I'm not going to go into them in depth here, but let's keep going on towards the stuff we're working on, the more exciting stuff for tonight. So I'm going to kind of go over four main areas here. So power, we're giving engineers the latest and greatest hardware, the power that they need, whether that's the Azure and H-Series, it's the new Knights Landing coprocessors, the latest and greatest for NVIDIA and the GPUs. And not only the cloud resources, but we're able to tap into your existing on-premise resources. So we're giving you a complete HPC global network to power your simulations. You can find the exact hardware you need, whether you're optimizing for performance, cost, interconnect, we have the right hardware for you. We're all about making engineers more productive. And a lot of the new features we're releasing will do just that, from advanced workflows. So an engineer doesn't have to become a software developer to create a nice multidisciplinary optimization or couple workflows together. They can do it easily from a browser-based interface. Persistent clusters, so you can easily iterate over your analysis. You'll get a brief demo of that. Improving our ability to keep track of the data, maintain the pedigree, understand you're using the right model, the right data set throughout time. And finally, make it easier to use and visualize your data directly in your browser. We're expanding new capabilities from our developer program, which I'll go into a bit more in a moment, to our ScaleX open platform. We're enabling open source communities to build and test and easily deploy their software right on Rescale. And as I mentioned earlier, the high-performance visualization uses the latest and greatest M60 GPUs from Azure. And finally, we're giving you insight into how you're using your software and how you can better manage your costs basically performance of your data all in Rescale. Now, ScaleX developer, we're developing this to allow you to easily bring your own custom software to Rescale. So you'll be able to use the same tools that our current engineers use to build and deploy, test, benchmark their software all in Rescale. You'll be able to distribute, you know, internal company applications to your own private GitHub repo, however you want to do this. We're going to make it easy for you to deploy and test it across all of the hardware that Rescale provides. Deep learning. Now, our algorithms expert, Mark Whitney, in the back. There he is. Thanks, Mark. He can walk you through this great example here where, you know, we're using deep learning to identify nerve structures in ultrasound images. NVIDIA K80 GPUs, Keras and TensorFlow. With Rescale, this is super simple, right? K80-backed Jupyter notebooks. You can use that to clean, pre-process the data, prep it, and then send it off, you know, to a cluster directly launched right within that notebook. You can make that, you know, as many GPUs as you need to process that data and easily bring that data right back in. We're expanding this to include support for Spark as well as, multi-node distributed training for Caffe and TensorFlow as well. All right, so now I'm going to give you a few brief demos of some of the exciting new features we're releasing on Rescale. So here you're looking at the Rescale interface. I'm about to submit a job. And you'll notice that one of the things I selected was this persistent cluster. So I'm starting, and I'm going to start a cluster. Now, typically with Rescale, we start resources for you on demand. So you start a job, you want to submit a job to us, we'll start up the resources, we'll start your job, configure it, do all that stuff. When it's done, we tear down those resources. Now, if you're doing something where you're kind of iterating through design really quickly, running small simulations, that can kind of, it's not as smooth of a workflow because you got to wait each time for the cluster to start up. Now, here I submitted my workflow. The job is running. You can see the files that are being generated. Now here I go look at this is a live view of the cluster, one of the output logs. You see I exited with an error, all right? So I can look back up at this file and see, you know what, I had a silly typo when I was entering the command I wanted to execute on the cluster. So now I can go ahead and just clone this job, go into my software, fix my command quite easily, and then submit this job again. Now, what you would have happened in the past is you have to wait a few minutes, 3, 4, 5 minutes, for that job to start up. Now with persistent clusters, now I go ahead and submit this job. And here, within a few seconds, the cluster is already running. And the job will start. And then you'll see the whole active workflow. So again, no need to wait 3 to 5 minutes. You can iterate quickly, run these jobs real fast. And as you can see, this one's working just fine, no errors. All right, in-browser desktops. So desktops are a remote visualization product. It allows you to do pre- and post-processing of your data before running them for batch compute. Here's a screen of an active desktop. Now, in the past, when you've wanted to connect a desktop, you would use either RDP or nice DCV to do that. You have to install software locally. There's a number of steps, download files. Not with this in-browser desktop. So now with a single click, I open it up in a new browser tab. I have a desktop running on Rescale. Again, no more software to install, no passwords to remember. It's just an easy click, and you're running. So now back to that view. This is the ANSYS. So we're back on a Rescale desktop, and here we're in the ANSYS native client. So this is a Workbench, their Workbench product. We're running a ANSYS mechanical problem. And some engineers prefer to stay in the actual software native clients. They don't need to go off to Rescale's browser-based interface. So what we've done is we've made it very easy to submit directly from within the GUI. So I just went ahead and selected remote. Rescale Gold, that's one of our core types. Parallel mode, 4 processors. I hit save and update, and that's it. Now I've got this job doing its simulation directly on Rescale. You'll see it pop up here in a moment. This is, the native Ansys monitoring that Rescale has integrated with. Now we'll just go back, and we can see back to the browser-based interface just to show that, you know what, this did actually go through and submit. So we go up to the job list, and there it is, running right there. Again, the engineer doesn't have to leave the interface. They can just stay right in the native Ansys client. Finally, we'll wrap up with the in-browser terminal. So this one's really nice. So Rescale has always had the ability, this is a job that's actively running, to view a list of files in the working directory, drill into those contents. You can even access via SSH. Again, you'd have to set up a key pair with us, set up access rules. You might have to install an SSH client. Well, now we've made it easy, so you can just have an SSH secure shell right in your browser. Click open a new window, and there you are. You're right on your cluster, ready to enter any commands you wish. So again, you can do the same kind of things we were doing in our window, list out files, tail a file. But you can do much more now. So you have the whole power of a shell right there. You can grep for stuff, search for files. You can add stop files. You can do anything you would want to do right within a browser shell. All right, so again, I'd like to highlight some of our partners here tonight. So Ansys and Microsoft, they have their booth back there. They have excellent startup programs that all work really well on Rescale. So encourage you, any startups, VCs, anybody in the startup ecosystem, to go talk to them tonight if you already haven't. That is it. That's you. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. And folks, that concludes Rescale Night San Francisco. Thank you so much for spending your evening with us. We're thrilled. The bar is still open. I just checked. They still have a lot of beer and wine. We put out some desserts, so don't leave. Let's network a little bit. Before we say goodnight, though, I just want to say thank you so much to our sponsors. You know who they are. You don't need a slide for that. Ansys, our platinum sponsor. Please go and see Matt and Ian in the booth in the back. They'd love to talk to you. If there's a lot of founders in the room tonight, there's a lot of startups. Definitely talk to Data Collective. Gene from Data Collective is here. Also talk to Elliot from Microsoft Ventures. They're also a sponsor tonight. And thank you. We'll see you at the next Rescale night. We will release a recording of this. Have a great night.